Welcome to another episode of Fresh Thinking by Snowden Optiro. My name is Ian Glacken. I'm an executive consultant with Snowden Optiro here in Perth, Western Australia. This is one of a series of podcasts focusing on fresh thinking that's actually been put into action. And we're focusing today on mine geology and ore control. Today I'm joined by Craig Morley. Craig Morley has joined us recently at Snowden Optiro. However, Craig has worked for Snowden much longer than I have. So he's rejoined us. Welcome, Craig.
Thanks, Ian. And it's good to be back.
Thank you. So, Craig, today we're going to talk about ore control and mine geology and innovations. Why do you feel that you're qualified to talk about this?
Yeah, I guess, as you mentioned, I had a long time at Snowden and consulting all over the world in mine geology. But for the last 9 years, I've been with a major mining house and responsible for implementing a range of innovations across mining operations all over the globe in different mining styles and in different locations.
We won't say what major mining house it is, but I'm sure people can look on your profile and see which one it is. So let's talk about some of those problems and innovations. Let's talk about a particular innovation that gave a big bang in return for a relatively small investment.
Yeah, I guess it was actually a really obvious one, but it's one of those things that goes under the radar a little bit on sites, is that when we blast something in an open pit, everything moves. But we use an in-situ model from the ore control or the grade control to quantify what material should go where. So we worked with a third party and said, you know, how hard would it be to be able to move the material on the computer when we blast it? And they did an amazing job, and we rolled this out across all of the operations, and yeah, it really added value being able to see what happened when the blast occurred and to make sure that we were sending the right material from the moved model to the processing plant.
Yes, I can say, having done some work recently at quite a few mine sites, I've seen the particular software product you're talking about. It's very commonly used, and it's an example of great innovation. So it certainly has gained some traction in the industry. So how do you match that with data innovation as part of the ore control processes?
Yeah, data is a really interesting thing, because we tend to take it for granted in terms of when it arrives. And we started to have conversations around the time value of information. So having data earlier in the process meant we could do more with the information. We could react. Getting data the day before you mine it is not as valuable and easy to use as getting it 6 months, 18 months ahead. So we started to look at using RC drilling in advance and that being able to have those models of what was in the ground and build that into the short-term mine plans. And that, again, added a lot of value. And if you Google Tribe Tech, you'll see a new fully automated RC rig that is being produced out of Ireland and rolled out around the world. It's very exciting.
Excellent. Yes, I can say, having been to quite a few mine sites, I hear the situation where talk to the geologists and they say, we've only got the RC data just back and they want to start mining it tomorrow. So that's a common thing. So let's just talk about the people element, the mine geologists. What sort of approaches have you seen or introduced with respect to collaboration at the mines?
Yeah, people are at the core. You know, a great example of a process is where we collaborated with the short-term mine planning team and mine geology and drill and blast, working on the concept of a blast master. And the idea is, because we had the information so far in advance of mining, we could get all the disciplines around the table, and we could look at a full bench in an open pit and say, you know, okay, what does the mine planners priorities? What are the geo's priorities? What does the plant want? How can we sequence the blasting and design the blasting around the end product rather than we just stop at the start at the bottom of the ramp and go around in a big circle? And the process enabled us to, again, add significant value rather than, yeah, just doing a monkey see, monkey do type approach.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I know that you've been a great proponent of the mine value chain and the mining value chain over your years at Snowden and since. And, you know, what is one particular area of the mine value chain where you've been involved in some innovative behaviour in defining solutions?
Yeah, I think two aspects. One, coming back to the stockpiles again. You know, stockpiles on our sites have always been black holes. It gets mined, it gets put on a stockpile, and we end up with, you know, 200,000 tons at one grade, you know, which is completely useless when we come to reclaim it. And so having stockpile block models, as you mentioned earlier, and we partnered with a Cambridge company to come up with the concept around how can you model it. We had to work cross-discipline. We had to work with the fleet management systems to get them up to speed in terms of telling us what material was coming from where and when it was dumped on the stockpile. They had to use physics engines to mimic the build and the reclaim of the stockpiles. But a lot of people will say, yeah, but how accurate is the stockpiles, you know, how much accuracy are you getting out of that data and all these manipulations that are done? Well, the answer is a little bit more accurate than just having a single number for every single ton, you know. Mm. So it's one of those things that comes back to George Box, you know, that all models are wrong, but some are useful. We found the stockpile block models extremely useful.
Yes, I can attest to that. And, you know, you and I both do a lot of reconciliation work. And, you know, I'd say almost half the issues with reconciliation are to do with stockpiles and particularly some of the mines you've worked out on and on. Well, thanks, Craig. That's really interesting. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
If you like this podcast, please subscribe. If you enjoyed that podcast, you'll find this and many like it on our website, the Snowden Optiro website. Also, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Libsyn, and where all good podcasts are found. And if you liked it, please subscribe. Thank you.